So Carlton Reed is very much in the cycle news business. He runs various websites. He goes and covers various sporting events, and also has some fairly famous websites like I Pay Road Tax and things like that. And quite frankly, a really good hero of mine. The other thing he does is he does lots of research. He goes and delves himself into archives in various places, like, for example, Ely tomorrow, I believe.
Because the Cambridge one is closed down.
Because the Cambridge one is closed down, you know, even though it's the county's... Yeah, no, anyway. So he goes and looks at old maps, and he discovers things like cycleways that were built in the 1930s, which he'll be talking about this evening. Carlton.
Robert, you can hold it.
Good evening. I've been here before, haven't I?
Yes.
And as a reminder, I've even been here before I started writing books. I came and actually got to talk to you on a bike industry thing a while ago. So as Robin was saying, I do lots of things. So one of the hats I wear is the executive editor of the Estuary at Large of bikebiz.com, which is an industry website. But then this project, which I'm going to be talking about tonight, which I'm sure some of you, but how many, but some of you will have backed, hopefully, on Kickstarter a wee while ago, is about something that came from, that's very nice of you, came from this book. So it's a chapter in that book. It was actually a slight snippet in the talk I've given here before on Road to the Car. So I talked about a 1930s cycle track. That's what they were called back then, so what we call today cycleways. There was a mention in that book about this one track in London, the first one. And that was roughly all that bike advocates, historians, really pretty much what knew about. And then for the second book, I started going into this in a bit more detail. And as I'll talk about in this talk coming up, I've now discovered there is at least 100 more. So I've discovered many of the paths, and certainly some of them are in Cambridge, where you might think, oh, that was probably put in the 1970s. It probably wasn't. It was probably actually put in the 1930s. So we want, all of us in this room, I am sure, and I will join with you, want to go Dutch. I know Cambridge is far more Dutch than, say, where I come from, which is Newcastle, but we'd still like to go Dutch. So this is a diorama that was put up in Newcastle a few years ago. But it illustrates that this is something that an awful lot of cycle campaigners and people on bikes want, is to go Dutch. And one of the things that stop us from going Dutch, we say to ourselves, is because we haven't got any infrastructure. If only we had infrastructure, we'd all be riding bikes everywhere. So what I've discovered is we did have infrastructure. We had a surprising amount of, for the time, and even today, because you are riding on some of these things today, which aren't that bad, there was tons of infrastructure out there. But when you look at world-class infrastructure, then you obviously go and you look at the Netherlands, or Copenhagen, where you had I believe Michael was here last year. Mm-hmm. I'm not a rock star, I can't fill his boots, but you had him last year, so he's Copenhagen. But this is Utrecht. This particular illustration. Can you see that? Am I blocking your way there? You're right. And we tend to think of always, it's very commonly common to say, we're 40 years behind the Netherlands. Well, we were 40 years behind the Netherlands then, but not now. We're about 110 years behind the Netherlands in infrastructure, because they started to become the leading cycling nation in about 1905, 1912, that's roughly when they started to build their superlative bicycle infrastructure. So within about 30, 40 years, they're getting pretty good at this, and this was planned pre-war. So this is I won't destroy the Dutch pronunciation of this, it's something like Baron Cool, but it means bear pit. And it's the bear pit because it's on a number of levels, and the cyclists are, as you can see, are beneath here, and they're coming through those tunnels here and through here. So there was this incredible infrastructure in the 1930s that was planned. It was actually built just after the war. But it was planned in 1936-1937. So again, you think, well, that's just, they were just so far away from us back then. But they weren't actually that far away from us at all. So this is a bike route, and a canal, and a railway line, and a road, and a pedestrian path between Haarlem and Amsterdam. And when this actual photograph of Dutch cycling infrastructure, and they had about 800 miles of roads and about 200 miles of infrastructure at this point, separate the cycling infrastructure did the Dutch. When this appeared in the Times in February 1934, the British Ministry of Transport saw this very photograph and said, we would like some of that. And so the Minister of Transport and his chief engineer, a guy called Colonel Bressy, contacted the Dutch Ministry of Transport. It's called the Rijkswaterstaat, so it's like the national infrastructure organization. It's been going since the 1700s. They've been doing very good world-class infrastructure for an awful long time, the Dutch. They looked at this and they said, we want something like this. So the director of the Rijkswaterstaat actually did loads of plans and said, well, we do them 12 foot wide, and they did all the plans in English. So I've seen all these plans at the National Archives, where the Dutch gave the Brits the full template of how to go Dutch. And it wasn't just, oh, that's nice. Yeah, we won't do anything about that. We'll just plod on doing our own thing. The minister said, right, let's build it. And within 6 months, they built the first protected cycleway. In the UK, in London, which will be a photograph I'll show you in a second. I'd like to show you how broad this was. So when I said in this book, I mentioned one, and historians and advocates said there was one or two, well, here is how many there actually are. And this is just, I think it's just actually, there's more. There's at least 100, perhaps more, and you can see there's a clustering in the southeast. There's a clustering in where I live as well, which has totally freaked me out, that Newcastle and the northeast of England was so good at this infrastructure. Not in Wales, not too sure why. But there's an awful lot of this stuff out there. So definitely in the southeast is where it was, because that's where the power is. Westminster is where the power still is concentrated. So it tended to be, you know, within about 20 miles of London, which got the most of the infrastructure. But as you can see at the top there, Cambridge absolutely got a bit. It wasn't just a plan to do 5 miles of this, 10 miles of this. You can actually see the Minister of Transport said, we're going to build 500 miles of this stuff. And when I go into the archives and I find more and more of these cycleways from the 1930s, I'm getting closer and closer to the 500 miles. And there are surprising long distance cycleways from the 1930s, some of which are buried, some of which are hidden in plain sight, in that you might have ridden on them, but you didn't know they were from the 1930s. There are some cycle superhighways in London, for instance, which you think, wow, they're beautiful, they're brand new, because they've got asphalt on, they've got a sign. They actually date from the 1930s. They've been around for an awfully long time. And 500 miles, I'm sure you'll agree, is an awfully long stretch to have. At that time, if we'd have done that, we would have been right smack bang up to Dutch levels, if that had happened. And that was what the Ministry of Transport were going for. They were definitely going for getting Brits onto bikes. Mainly, of course, because the politicians and the doctors, the intelligentsia wanted the cyclists off the roads so they could drive faster. That was definitely one of the reasons for building these cycleways, but also when you look at the archives, it was very much safety, because we know people die on bikes today. Back then, they were dropping like flies. They were really getting hit and killed just so often. It's frightening how many cyclists were dying in those times. So there was a definite desire to get cyclists off the roads, build them proper infrastructure. It really was, they were talking about building proper infrastructure and looking to the Dutch example. So, southeast London has got a fair bit. And not only has it got the odd scheme. When I started plotting this, when I researched these things, and it was only when I actually got onto Google Street Maps and started dropping the pins in that you suddenly realise these are not just the odd little scheme that doesn't connect with each other. These are definitely connecting with each other. So when there's a little dot here, that doesn't mean it's just one little stretch. That could be all the way along here, all the way along. These are long stretches, and they're linking up. A lot of these places were connected. Bicycle infrastructure, which is what we dream of today, was there in the 1930s. Of course, there were places where there was no infrastructure, and then that's the weakest link, of course. However, there was a makings of a Dutch-style network. So that's my discovery. This is the first cycleway that was constructed. This is the one that was constructed in a hurry. So the minister, it was the minister before Belisha, who I got on to, Belisha Beacons, that guy, he commissioned this one. This was opened in December of 1934, but it was actually physically built in something like June, July. So they actually said, go and build it, and they built it instantly and put really rubbishy concrete down. So the first one was dire. So the site, is anybody cyclist touring club here? Not just members, or any officials, or... So I can be totally rude. No, I'm rude. I'm rude. The CTC, which is now Cycling UK, famously was dead set against the cycleways of the time. But when you actually could see why and how this degraded and how the factories that grew up around it suddenly made it less useful, you can see why the CTC would be against this particular cycleway. So that is the one that's always rolled out. It's the one I rolled out in my first book. It's the one that advocates some famous blog postings about how in 1934 it went downhill to Brits ever since this was built. Yes, that one was a duff one. The ones that came afterwards, and they were scientifically tested, so if you go to the National Archives, you can actually get all of the concrete sampling cores, and they were actually trying to work out why this was so bad. And they designed all of the flaws in this one out. So yes, the first one was poor. Subsequent ones weren't poor at all. So this is the reason why they wanted to build these things. If you wanted your nice, smart motor car to get along on the roads of Britain back then, you had to get the cyclists out of the way because the cyclists were the majority users of the roads. So in 1936, 37, you'd have maybe 2 million motorists. There were at least 12 million cyclists, people on bikes. Mainly people, by this time, it was no longer a middle class thing, it was very much a working class form of transport. So when you had this many people in front of you, in your car, if you're this is the Barrow and Furness, if you're the manager of Barrow and Furness and you're coming out in your car and you're stuck behind these guys, who are your social inferiors, that he might have thought, then that would annoy you. And you would be the part and parcel of pushing to get cyclists, these pesky cyclists, out of the way by creating this infrastructure. But the point is, they did build that infrastructure. So I've used Google Street View as my resource. So when I can't go to every single place in the country and research this, when I've got such an amazing resource there on my computer. So I know what a 1930s cycleway, I'll show some of them in closer detail in a sec, but I know roughly what they look like. I know the kind of features which they have. I can actually date concrete. I'm that sad. I can actually look at concrete and go, yeah, that's cool. That's how sad I've become. I know that those kind of details. But I use Google Street View, and then I can flag up, somebody will either tell me, or I'll work out, right, there was a 1930s road built there. Chances are there will be cycleways there because the local authorities at the time would only get fat road building grants, sometimes up to 100% grants from the Ministry of Transport, if they put cycleways in. So back then, they really were determined to get cycleways everywhere. So you'd get 75 to 100% grants for putting cycleways in next to your main roads. So I use Google Street View, and I can go out there without having to visit. What you do get, it's like a parallelogram view, where this doesn't look that wide. This is a cycle route in Manchester. That doesn't look that wide because it's from the point of view of the Google Street car. And it's only when you actually get on the cycleway itself and you're going to visit it in the flesh, you go, wow, this is really quite impressive. So what I've been doing, I've been going out there with my own Google Street View camera, in effect. And I've been, as many of the cycleways as I can, I take 3D photographs of them, 360 degree photographs of them. So I can then do a Google Street View. So you can now click on some of them in Google Street View, and you can now go along them without having to be in the Google Street car, because I've done this. And that's one of the next things I want to do, is map these and photograph these, so you can actually go and visit them and see it without having that parallelogram view. So you can actually see how impressive these things were. To get the camera, to get the drones, which you'll see in a minute, for getting the bird's eye view of them, and for just doing the research, and importantly, for employing John Street Dales on Twitter, who's an urban designer, to actually take some of these 1930 cycleways and bring them up to date. We took this through Kickstarter. So, could I have a show of hands? Anybody in here is a Kickstarter backer of this project? Four or five? Well, thank you very much for this. This is enabling these kind of talks and this kind of technology to bring these things back. So we raised £25,000, which for an obscure history project, I would say is pretty damn good. So I'm spending it on lots of holidays to the Bahamas. So the main photograph that I used for the Kickstarter campaign was this one. And this is, does anyone know Manchester? This is near the Trafford Centre. So the Trafford Centre back then, now it's a shopping mall, back then it was an armaments factory. It was electronics, and then it was turned into armaments during the war. So they had to get the people to get to those factories. They built an awful lot of council housing, and then they built these very impressive, very, very wide, very well serviced. These, you can't see this because it's black and white photograph, these are violent pink. These cycleways, you can see now, if you go there, you can see underneath where they've resurfaced it in parts, you can actually see the pink. It's faded, but you can see the pink cycleway surface. They actually dyed the concrete, so the concrete was pink. And then during the war, they would paint these things white. So they were all installed in. I'm doing a PhD on this subject. And for my PhD, it's in the University of Eindhoven. With this particular photograph, I switched it, flipped it around, and there's a lot of PhD students, and all the professors were sitting there, and saying, you know what, listen, and we were describing photographs. And they were describing how this was the Netherlands, and obviously this date, and this is this car, and that's obviously, this retract is like, no, it's Manchester. And they flipped it and said, look, it's that, they're travelling that way around. And they all went, oh. We had no idea the Brits had that kind of stuff at the time. This was actually in Cycling Weekly. It was like cycling at the time, this particular illustration is where I found it. And the caption underneath, amazing to our ears, says, do not ever use these things, I'm paraphrasing here a little bit, these are the spawn of the devil. Do not use cycleways. They are awful. And it's like, oh, there's a nice one, there's a young lady on. What's their problem? That this is clearly okay. So there was an enormous amount of kickback from the cycle organisations of the time. And as I said before, you can imagine that on the first one. Yes, that was dire. But when they're starting to build Lostock Road in Manchester, and this goes to the Trafford Centre, it goes from here, it goes from there. It's a big network in Manchester of protected cycleways. It's like, why were they quite so... I know why they were, but it's still, to modern it, it's just strange that they were so...
Well, presumably no priority intentions.
There absolutely is that. I'll show you some photos in a bit where the priority isn't there. However, on Lostock Road, interestingly enough, there is some priority. So you can actually look on the road, on Google Street View, and you can actually see where the priority has been given to cyclists. in the 1980s. It's all been faded away now there, but it'd be interesting to find out how long that priority has existed. We knew it was there in the 80s. Did it predate that? Because this one was like a flagship route, so very possibly the priority was there for such. So some definitely did have priority, but a lot of them, yeah, required. So this is what it looks like today. It's the same one. Let's go backwards. It's a slightly different place. But I was photographing here with my gimbal and my iPhone going along, and I was accosted by all these people. I was accused of being a paedophile. Because, mental note, do not photograph cycleways outside schools at 3:20 in the afternoon. Because you will be chased by people thinking you're up to no good. And I'm thinking, I'm a historian. They didn't really buy any of that at all. But this group here, they got very aggressive with me. So I scarfed them. But it is up both sides of the road. So it's been resurfaced. But these are original curbings. That side of the road. And it goes for 3 or 4 miles. There's been a truncation because there's been a motorway put in. And the road is differently named. But at one point, this was quite a long and impressive and well-used route. I've had oral histories with people who have told me how well this used was by the armed factory people in the 1930s and 1940s. But this is what happens to them. Because they're wide, because they're well-surfaced, because they look like little private roads for motorists, that's what they're used for today. So it's actually unusual to get that view. Normally, it's that view. So motorists have basically just considered these their own. And the local authority on one side of the road has allowed it. So they changed the bylaws to say you can. The other side of the road, they're illegal. But on this particular side of the road, they are actually technically allowed to be on there. That's our infrastructure. That was built for us. And it's been parked on, and you'll see more photographs of that. This is a very common theme. And this is one of the reasons why we don't recognise 1930s infrastructure, because there's bloody cars on it. You can't recognise it because you can't actually see it. So, an awful lot of these were built from housing, to council housing, to factories. But the majority of them were built on the new arterial roads. So the 1920s, 1930s, there was a big, big push to get the roads improved. An awful lot of roads were built from scratch. And if you look in the National Archives at the Ministry of Transport maps of the time, the green are all the cycleways that were put in. So these are, there's some here that are like they're planned. These were actually put in. So I just put that in just because of the new Cambridge Road. Just because it says Cambridge. But that's Tottenham here. And this, it still exists. You can, there's but again, it's just people are parked on that particular infrastructure. If you zoomed out, in a national, yeah, you've got M25, if you zoom out, then you'd see, if there was a map, there is a map, but if you were, you would just see all of these arterial roads of the time would have cycleways next to them. So it was the bypass roads, which would have the cycle infrastructure put in, which you can imagine wouldn't be the most salubrious place to go cycling, you would imagine. In fact, the cyclists of the day loved the 1930s bypasses because there was no cars on them. They, in effect, had dual carriageways to themselves. So this is another one of them when people like to give these kind of talks, the people say, well, why do people use the cycleways? Like, why would you need to use the cycleways? There's very few cars around. The ones that are there are killing you. But generally, there aren't that many cars around. You've got the roads to yourself, and you've got cycleways there. Well, do you need to use the cycleways? So they were actually built, perhaps, ahead of their time, in that there were so many cyclists, they were so dominant on the roads, you almost didn't need them. It's very different today, I know, but back then, there's a kind of reason why they may not get used. So it's the bypass roads where they were mainly built, which is, they don't be going there. They're going somewhere, if you're going fast, in a car, city to city, but generally, for a cycle use, they're not really in the right place. So that's another reason why they don't get used. And they just fall out of use. So this is the A45 in Coventry. And there are bits further Sad for this, where it does actually look footpathy, stroke, cyclopathy, and you can imagine what it was. And then you get further on where there's junctions have truncated the cycleways. And then nobody apart from mad guys like me are now going to have a look at this, because nobody will see this. It's very rare that obviously anybody's going through it. But that was a long distance 1930 cycleways underneath that. And there's all sorts, if you look at the area closely, you will see lots of period infrastructure that shows you that the era these were built. This is when I can start dating concrete. So the concrete posts, the wooden signs, they made a really big effort to actually make these things. They were quite pleasant at the time. They really beautified the roads. They don't look so nice now, but at the time they made a big effort into making these things look quite nice. And then, this is the same road, it's called the Fletch-Hampstead Highway. In between there, somebody's nicely cut it away, but it's just one of the old road signs on this particular bypass. So all the bypasses in the UK would have had these nice Art Deco-y type things. So a lot of factories were built along these roads, all of them are Art Deco factories. And these are the signposts that the cyclists would see. So this is a rather fussy icon for a bike, and that lasted right the way through to about 1968, that icon for bikes. Even from the 1930s, the convention was far too fussy. But these are the signs.
Is that great?
These are the signs that would be beside the cycleways. So this is what they look like here. So this is a 1950s soap advert, but it is talking about cyclists you should use in cycle tracks, but there's one of these cyclists only, sorry, backwards, cyclists only things. And I've never found one in situ. I'd love to find one in situ. So that one is from Beamish Museum. So they'll just put it on a wall. I'd love to find one. These things were not 1 mile, 2 miles long. Some of them were, the Thanet Way was 20 kilometres, 15.26 miles of continuous protected cycleway. This one, Southend Arterial Road, was actually even longer. This is something like 22 miles from Romford all the way to Southend. If you know Southend, Southend has actually got some pretty good cycling infrastructure up to the outskirts of town, but then this takes over and it's still there underneath the road. So this is me superimposing Google Street View with a 1930s plan. So the cycle track is on the plan and it is still there, you just don't recognise it as a cycle track. So underneath the Southend Arterial Road, there's 20 miles of fully protected cycling infrastructure, some of which actually mesh with today's network. So now that we know, and Southend didn't know this, now that we know that this exists, so these are the kind of routes that we could actually bring back, if we wanted to. If John Dale says, I think cyclists will go from here to here to here, let's bring this stretch back, we'll get in there with our shovels, or the local authority will get in there with their shovels, and we'll bring some of these routes back. This is what they look like in town. So these are like new arterial roads. This is Erdington in Birmingham. You can see two cyclists coming out of this cycleway here, and you can see the entrance to that cycleway, and that, I'm presuming, must be, even though it's kind of pointing the wrong way, that must have been the cycle track sign. But if you go to today, that's the same cycle, that's where they're coming out of, and that's where they're going into. If you go click through on that particular image a couple of times, you will see everybody's just parked in there, so further up. So it's not really used as a cycleway, but it's absolutely usable as a cycleway if you got rid of the cars. This is Twickenham. Again, a new road. It became less useful when they built lots of factories and it got built up, but that's what it looked like at the time. So this kind of this white concrete, vivid white concrete, is you can tell the cycleways compared to the roads. This is what it looks like now in Twickenham. I like this particular one because if you go on that cycleway in Google Street View, even without my cameras, you can actually drive along this because the Google streetcar drove along it until it got to the bollards at the end and went, oh. So it's actually driven along a 1930 cycle. So that's the only cycle that I know of that you can get a very, very good view of now on Google Street View, because the Google Street View camera went up there and then couldn't get any further. Box Hill, Surrey. These are called the Mickleham Bends. This is the Mickleham Bypass in that part of the world. And again, you can see this is actually when the white road, the concrete road, and the cycleway is the same colour. Within about 2 to 3 years, the roads, any roads that were built in this time, were very quickly covered with asphalt. So the concrete roads didn't last that long. They were just covered. But the cycleways tend to stay. So that's when you can look in aerial photographs, that's when you can tell they're cycleways, because they were left as cycleways. You can see quite a few cyclists there coming around that particular corner. But here, that's the one road. So, and they're actually two abreast as well. So that would inflame the Daily Mail if they saw that photograph. But then you have got some on some roads to bicycles. This is what it looks like today. So backwards, you can see how wide it is there. There is a slight parallelogram here where the car's the full width, but that's basically a sliver. And it really is just used as a footpath.
What reason why did they use concrete rather than asphalt? Did they just not have access to it, or did they just think concrete was better then?
The asphalt wasn't as good at that time.
Uh-huh.
So it was actually 1902 in Geneva, Cyclist Touring Club were the ones who perfected or did street trials for asphalt. But they still wasn't that good for long distance use. So it took a while before it's formulas. And it took a long time before they actually got the right formulas for asphalt to be non-slippy and to be long lasting. Mm. So they could get one or two of the properties, they couldn't get it all together. But by the end of the 1930s, I guess because of the war, a lot of this was just perfected. And then after the war, everything was just slapped with asphalt because it became much, much cheaper. Because concrete does crack, as we know. It cracks, whereas asphalt tends not to.
It was hot rolling that made the difference with asphalt, wasn't it?
There's all sorts of technologies.
And that's the technology they didn't.
Because they were just doing it by hand, which is very labour intensive. And then when they get the machines doing it, it just changes. But they were making the roads concrete, asphalt. And the cycle track has been asphalted there, that's recent.
It's quite common that there are concrete under an asphalt covering.
Oh yeah, yeah,
totally. Cambridge still has several which are a maintenance nightmare.
Oh yeah, well even the roads, everything would be concrete underneath. I very much doubt that dug any of it up. They would have kept the concrete.
Well, the joints keep going, it's a nightmare for Bridge Street and Cambridge, for example, keeps going.
So as you can see on here, it's a much, much inferior cycle. To what they had back then, and probably people don't consider it much of a cycleway because it looks like a truck path, it doesn't look like a cycleway at all today. So, shooting north, this is my part of the world. This is actually John Dale's part of the world, this is where he comes from. This is Whitby Bay on the northeast coast. This is a 1950s home movie. I watched this. And the 1 second, 2 seconds of 1930 cycleway. I wouldn't quite know what that is. And I stopped it and realised what it was. And so that's the cycleway there. And there with my drone, I've been up and had a look at it. And it ain't half bad. Apart from, Simon, what you're saying, apart from this. that's the problem with the 1930 cycleways. You know, the motorists have got very nice, fast, sweeping corners. So of course the cyclists don't have that fantastic a time on it. And this one isn't a very long one. This one goes from about here to there. They were going to build this road around to there. It would have been a very nice cycleway and a very nice road, but they just stopped there in 1930. They didn't continue it around. It just becomes a bit of a dogleg. Also northeast of England, this is probably one of the best cycleways, and it's almost certainly one of the least used. This is in Sunderland, it's actually the Durham Road here, and along here was a tram, But these cycleways, this is the same surface as was built. I just left it. Amazing. This is one of the routes where I'd actually not like to improve this one. I'd actually like this one to be listed as a heritage thing. So we actually keep it. But literally nobody is using this as a bike route at all. I've been here multiple times, and I'm the only cyclist ever on this bit of infrastructure. And floating bus stops are the thing that we're meant to be terribly poor at, and we've only just rediscovered. No, they had them in Cambridge. They certainly had them in Sunderland in the 1930s, floating bus stops. And in the video for the Kickstarter project, there's a roundabout at the top here. It's a protected roundabout. It's a Dutch-style protected roundabout. So if you look on the video, you can actually see me cycling around the protected arm. One, it's only one arm, but it's protected. And again, it's an innovation that we assume we can't. British engineers can't build this. Yes, they can, because they built it in the 1930s.
That angled curve as well.
Sorry?
That angled curve as well.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, geeks, leave.
No, good point, yeah. So this is what that would have looked like. So again, here's the cycleway, here's the footpath. This was ripped out in 1955, it's now just a green sward of grass. But when I'm searching for photographs, they don't label them as 1930 cycle track. You've always got to look for the roads themselves and then just hope that you actually get a shot of the cycleway that there is there. This is another one that I'd like to be listed rather than improved. Again, it's something that nobody generally uses. This is the A1, as was. So this was the Great North Road. This is Neville's Cross in Durham. This has got like a 2-3 mile, that's my daughter. Both sides of the road, 9 foot wide, concrete, fully protected, curved, not those kind of curves, but protected with curves. This is what it looked like when they were building it. A lot of the cycleways and the roads, of course, of the time, and any building stuff at the time, they were actually doing it to get people work back to work. So an awful lot, when you look in the archives, an awful lot of the people who are working on these things were unemployed men. And that, I assume, is why in the Northeast there's quite a few cycleways, because they wanted to get working men who weren't working back to work. And it was only at the end of this period, about 1939, 1940, when you started to get specialist road builders. Up until then, you have one surveyor, and everybody else was unskilled. After this period, they became skilled in their own right. But at this point, they're pretty much just building these under supervision. And that's what they look like. That's what they looked like back then. So this was the A1. This is the Great North Road. And it looks like that now. I'll put a photo up. It looks like that now. That has virtually remained unchanged. That's there, the tree's probably not the same one. That sign's not there, but this is here. This cut here, all of that is all still here. And there's white lines still there. I actually stood in exactly the same place here and taken a photograph of that bit here, so it really hasn't changed. And that's what it looks like today, and that's how good the curving is. Again, that's my daughter, and this is both sides of the A1, both sides of the road, with this concrete surface. It is a bit bumpy. Roadies tend to go here when they come past. Virtually everybody else, when I've been sat there and photographing it, cycles here. Nobody cycles on the 1930 cycling infrastructure, not because the surface is bad. If you've got a touring bike, you've got an ordinary bike, it's actually fine. Brompton, it's absolutely fine. It's only when you've got like, skinny tyres when it's not so fine. The rest of the time it's actually okay. But people ride on here because they just don't realise that, well, of course that's not a cycle. It's really wide and it's nice. It can't be for us. So they just cycle. It freaks me out when I see it. People are just riding. I almost want to stop them and say, why? Because they don't. Sometimes I see motorists up here as well, so people do drive on it. Even though it doesn't really go anywhere, They just assume it's a road. It's wide, it's well surfaced. It must be for us. It must be for the locals. Staying in the northeast. This is in Blythe. That's Blythe up here. The footway is being taken over by motorists, but the cycleway, these concrete things here, are still in situ. This one is buried, so it's there. Originally, it would have gone up here on both sides, and it had gone through town, and then it's through Seaton Sluice, it goes right the way around here. It's an impressive bit of infrastructure you can still use. However, the Sustrans route, the cycle route that's used now, virtually nobody uses this as a cyclist goes along here. They all go on this one. Because that's the way that the National Cycle Network goes. But actually, the built for cyclist infrastructure, which is actually better than that, is still there. Cambridge. Uh-huh. So this is the bridge that I used to mark the fact that I was coming here. 1939, Cambridge Daily News. It says, if you can read that, it's talking about between Ditton Walk and Newmarket Road, which means they hadn't actually named Wadlow's Road. Am I pronouncing that right? Wadlow's Road. They hadn't named it at that point, but this is Wadlow's Road. So there's houses here now. So these houses were built, but then there's more houses put in.
Those houses in different fields, I think.
Mm-hmm. So 1939, it actually says, which is an innovation in this district, which I find quite strange, because I know for a fact that Newmarket Road had cycle tracks on it. So it's strange that they've said an innovation. Maybe they just mean the width of it, or the degree of the curving, I don't know. But
I think the ring road was the innovation.
Right.
Because it never got built, of course.
Did you mean this ring road?
Yeah. Oh, sorry, it was part of a ring road.
Well, it was going to say it's Wadlow's Road there.
Yes.
So that's, I'm presuming the photograph has been taken somewhere like that. And in fact, that right there, because they're the houses that are going off to there. There's now houses built in between here. This doesn't fit with the normal pattern. Wadlow's Road doesn't fit with the normal pattern. It normally has to be, generally has to be along an arterial or a factory. It sticks out to me as something a bit strange. But it was only when it was pointed out that this is the Cam Causeway, and this was going to be, the whole of this was going to be the Eastern Bypass. So the reason they put the cycle infrastructure on the Wadlow's Road and didn't go anywhere was because this was going to be a major road, and you can see the cycleways. They have got to be the cycleways put in, because they're the cycleways, they're definitely the cycle tracks. So these white bits, before the road gets put in, it appears as though they're putting the cycleways in. But that's where it would have gone. That would have been a major, major road, which of course...
But the frontage housing was only built in the 60s.
Yes.
Does anybody know whether the Barnwell Road, the way up alongside Barnwell Road, whether that's part of this same scheme?
Yeah, it's on that picture.
Wait, is Barnwell Road, is it this?
The southern one,
yes. Yes,
yes. Yeah,
it has to be, yes. This is why I need to go to the archives to absolutely nail these things down. But from aerial photographs, that would absolutely suggest it, because that we know what that is, so that must be the same thing. And we know it's there now, so dating it must be...
Well, Barnwell Road was a cul-de-sac for cars until the 70s.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the cycle track was already went through, because the railway bridge was only put in the 70s, but I think there was a facility to go under the railway for bicycles.
Okay. Oh, no, I'm going to absolutely nail all this down when I get to the archive. Mm-hmm. So Newmarket Road, sorry. So Newmarket Road here, definitely had cycle tracks on this. That way, for sure. I know they had it quite a few miles going that way. All out that way. But here's Matt's. Where's Matt? Thank you, Matt, for supplying you going out and then you have another lead. So you can see that's very similar to the Durham concrete, the Durham curving. It just has all the hallmarks of even without knowing the history of it, you can pretty much tell that must have been built at that point, because it looks so similar to the other stuff that was built at that point. So without even going out there, I know that this will be 9 foot wide, because the good ones were built 9 foot wide, the duff ones were built 6 foot wide. And I do get on my hands and knees, and I do double check these things, but they're always 9 foot. They're just absolutely to the letter. So they're all 9 foot wide cycleway. And again, I'm assuming, I don't know there was a bus stop there at the time, in period times. I'm assuming there must have been, because when you look on 1945 Google Earth, you can actually see where bus stops are, and they actually tend to, bus stops don't migrate.
I think that bus stop is post-70s, actually. Well,
Yeah, the actual
shelter
is.
No, no, no. The original route up Newmarket Road went to the city boundary at Meadowlands Road. I don't think you went through that estate.
You don't think that will be period for a bus?
It's certainly not 39. There were no houses to serve.
No, the estate that route goes through
was mostly built par walk.
It's post
war. Only Ditton Fields were built for war.
What's the bus stop in for the giant road that was supposed to be there?
Yeah, that's potential.
The point is the bus stop went to Meadowlands Road, which was the city boundary. In those days, they literally made the bus routes end at the city boundary. Right. It's not the only example.
Oh, that's good info. I'll use that.
Yeah. Meadowlands Road isn't served anymore.
Okay. So again, this is Matt's photograph of the same relatively same infrastructure. You'll know well, I'm sure.
This one's on Barnwell
Road. Right, so this is the southern one. So we don't know, because we just assume that that must be 1930s. We haven't pinned it down.
Yeah, it's not got a lot of the attributes of the film.
It hasn't, because it's well separate from the road. So it's certain things that don't go with it.
I've always thought this was going to be a dual carriageway at this point.
Bungle Road may well have been.
So in other words, it might have been a cycle track here.
Where the trees are would be where the other carriageway would have been, and then another two lanes on the far side. They only built two lanes.
The houses were only built on the other side and not until quite late in the 60s.
Well, when I get into the archives, after they've moved...
My daughter lives opposite that cycle.
Right. Well, I will go and double check that, but it just assumes that... I don't know. But these are definitely 1930s. So again, this is the A1303 at the time in the 1930s was the A45. So even though it says A103 there, it wasn't back then. So that's what it looks like today at this exact location, and it does go. So it's basically, it is under there. This is a part of the project where it becomes archaeology. We're going to dig these things up. John Stevenson, who I'm sure you all know, he went out and took that photograph. Again, it's roughly the same stretch, where you can just see the infrastructure is there. It's absolutely not being cared for. It absolutely could be brought back if enough people wanted that particular stretch to be brought back. Going back to London. This is Leominster Walk in Morden. This is the St. Helier Estate. These are the very famous European terms. The St. Helier Estate was one of the biggest council house estates in Europe at the time. And they built these very fine cycleways, demarcated and gated off in effect from the footways and the road. And because that's an exact location, the Google Street View, you can go to the exact location today, and you can see what it looks like. And you can see there's the image of the walk there. You can see the footpath is still there, but the cycleway has been stolen. They've taken it away from us. So they've just made it into a linear car park, both sides of the road, obviously put a bus stop in, street furniture in, so that mighty fine cycling infrastructure from the 1930s has now just gone. But here's what it looked like. This is the same road. This is St. Helier Avenue in Morden, and you can see the very straight cycleways here. And it doesn't appear to be that many roads, so they actually had the run of that. There was no motor traffic, in effect, to get in the cyclist way. And again, both sides of the road. So Leominster Walk is up here, and it was both sides of the road. And there is an on survey map again. You can just zoom in, and you can see where the 1930 cycleway is. This is 1977, so an archive photograph from then. And you can see that telltale entry point, 1930s telltale entry point into a cycleway, and a telltale local car parking where the local locals have just taken the cycleway for themselves. Just look at that, and then look at this. It's still there. That has got to be the same sign from 1977. It's still there. This is, I haven't been here yet, so it's still Google Street View. But again, so the curve in comes in here. This is the cycle infrastructure, this is the protected cycleway. And look, all the cars are just parking here. And they're now saying, the local authority is saying, right, cyclist, you go there. You go on this bit here, and that's where they're designed to be. That's where cyclists were meant to go. Before, of course, people in this, certainly in this part of the world, were expected to have cars. Nobody expected people to be owning as many cars as we have. So, still in London, the A12, again, very similar in that there's some sort of fence protecting the pedestrians and the cyclists. There's nothing there for the cars and the cyclists, but there's a curb, and this is what the exact same stretch looks like today. Again, cars have just taken over the cycle infrastructure, and then look what we get now. We get sheltered onto the carriageway with trees. That's what we should have. That's ours. These cars should be there. Get them off. That's ours. This is what we'll be going to local authorities with. We'll be going with archive photographs and saying, look, that's ours. Get these people off. It's not theirs. It was built for us. With history, you can actually do something in the present day, hopefully. So that has been my talk. It's a part from a slight part of Bike Through. I've got a few copies here today. And this is supported by Brompton and by Shannon's Pass. Thank you.
Does anybody have any questions? Yes.
Sustrans as well. So they went to Lostock Road, and it was really interesting. The Sustrans people on the ground had no, even though they lived there, they had no idea they had this infrastructure because the cars parked on it, and they were like freaked out. They're like, "Well, we could get these cars off, and we could use this again," and they just didn't realise they had it.
Colin,
When I cycled along the Embankment Cycleway in London, I'm always reminded that that was a reserved space. It wasn't available for motor cars until 1952 because it was a reserved track tramway.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that it's now going back to non-car use, because I don't think enough has been made of that really, because certainly at the time it was put in, it was a great fuss about loss of road space.
And when the embankment was first put in, it was allowed, cyclists were allowed and posh carriages were allowed, but the HGVs of the day weren't allowed. So you couldn't get lorries, the equivalent back then, the Teamsters.
It's interesting, as a tramway, it was a major public transport artery. There were no bus routes along there at all now.
Mm. Yeah, no, you're completely right.
Cool. Some of the local ramblers here are looking at much older routes than these. They're looking at the time when we got enclosures coming in here in the early 19th century, and finding what trackways existed then, not just paths, but also trackways, and of course, claiming these back. They're claiming these routes across farmland in particular that should be routes and should be made available. And of course, if they're trackways, they would be available for cyclists too. Now, the maps exist for the situation at the beginning of the enclosure period.
Mm.
And in Cambridge that happened relatively late compared with other parts of the country, and many of them date from the early 19th century.
The phrase there that is used is called once a highway, always a highway. So if you can go back in history, find out that there was, in effect, wheeled traffic using that particular route, you can then go through the long and laborious process of going to your local court system and bringing it back. It falls down on the fact that local authorities have cut back on all of their funding for the Rights of Way network. So there's basically 10, 20 years worth of finding these kind of trackways and trying to bring them back into use. It's fiendishly difficult, and it basically relies on people, as you're saying, researching in their spare time, presenting to magistrates, and then maybe winning that particular case. But it would only become like a bribeway. So the cyclist would then be allowed on if it's made into a bribeway. You've got to get onto what's called the definitive map. So if you can get yourselves that route onto the definitive map, it then becomes like enshrined for all time. The government, in its wisdom, has given a cap on that and saying there's going to be a cut-off date. If you don't get it, it keeps on getting sent backwards. If you don't get it onto the definitive map soon, it will never be on the definitive map. So people are now racing to get this done, but the wheels of local authority right-of-way network officers go very slowly. So it's so tough to get them brought back.
When is the cap?
It was meant to be 2 years ago, it's now 3 years hence. It's just, it's not a priority. They just keep on moving. It constantly gets moved. Sorry?
I thought Cambridge just declared it done, but maybe.
I don't know. Nationally, it should be a national thing. It hasn't been clamped on.
Certainly aware of a Cambridge clone that's still not resolved itself, isn't it?
They're so difficult because you've got landowners who want, you know, to keep it this way, and you've got recreation users, and the ramblers don't want the cyclists on it, and the cyclists don't want these, don't want e-bikes on it, and it just becomes incredibly difficult.
And then it goes to a public inquiry.
Yes. Yes, and again, it takes many, many years. So
yeah.
It's question over here.
Were there any efforts to try and get the cyclists off the newly built dual carriage road, like legal enforcement? You're saying that.
No. The interesting thing, when you look in the archives, the National Archives, for what the Minister of Transport and his chief engineer and his officials, or the officials, when they were talking about these cycleways, they never ever said we must get cyclists off. They had personal correspondence from friends, like Colonel so and so, whatever, said you must get these cycles off. And the minister would then write back to his personal friend and say, I do appreciate your point of view, however, there are no plans. This was never published, this is all behind the scenes. The CTC and British Cycling of the day said, no, government plans for cyclists to use these cycleways and get them off dual carriageway. I have found zero evidence for that, quite the contrary. The CTC at the time were very suspicious, and actually, if only they had known, they needn't have been. The minister had no influence on doing this. This is like the free-born rights of English people. Yeah. It was so entrenched, they wouldn't have done that.
Yeah.
In the Netherlands, they could do that because they've got a very different system, very different rights-of-way system as well, where you could restrict, and they have been restricting usage of canal paths and roads and where horses could go for 300 years. We had no history of restricting use. We could go anywhere. On the King's Highway, you can trample down crops, you can do anything. The freeborn right of an English person is to go anywhere on the King's Highway. And once a highway, always a highway. So Brits would not have ever allowed their rights to be extinguished. Sometimes they were voiced, the Daily Mail types of the time, asked for it, officials would never have done it. So no, it's the answer.
Do you think that's been actually one of the biggest problems, you know, historically, that there was a push to make sure that cyclists could carry on using the main carriage road?
It was always the bête noire of the CTC. Yeah. That was what they feared. That's what they feared all the way through the 60s and 70s and 80s, a bit in the 90s. Even still now, you will get it sometimes worse. We'll be pushed off, we'll be forced to use these things. Mm-hmm. And there's never, ever been a push for that.
Any question over here?
I was familiar with the Great West Ride something like 40 years ago,
mm-hmm.
Which had quite a nice cycleway by the side of it, and which, as you say, had all the Art Deco buildings or whatever. And I remember pounding down there as a 40 years ago, and finding that a street light had been installed, and that there was a foot wide trench straight across it. And I only just realised in time before I actually went into that. So I would say that it's not just parking of cars and that kind of thing. I'm reminded of that because I was down in the same area about 6 or 8 weeks ago, and it did appear that different boroughs had a different attitude to how they used these, whether they put fences across at the intersections and that kind of thing, or whether they resurfaced them and that kind of thing. As a trunk road, I'm a little bit surprised by that almost clear change as one goes from one borough to another. Can you say, is this kind of inner London, outer London, or something like that? Who's responsible for the way in which these things are kept up?
You're right, it's absolutely right. The different local authorities will treat these things so differently. I can look at this in the archives, in that some archives will be perfectly indexed, will have all the information, will have the attached plans. These were clearly people who cared about their bureaucracy, and they probably also cared about their infrastructure. And then you go to other local authorities, which is very slapdash. There's no archive, there's no index, there's not, it's so difficult to find information. They haven't got plans with it. They were clearly slapdash in the way they probably also did their infrastructure. Because there were so many borough councils, so many road authorities, by this time there's about 450, 500 around England. So you could sometimes go, not so much on a cycleway, but on a road, where one stretch of road, you could go, in 10 miles, you could go over five different local authorities, five different borough road engineers, and you could be bumpy in 1 minute, smooth, bumpy, smooth, and the motorists at the time very much complained about this. So I'm assuming it must have been the same for the cycleways. They'll have been good in parts, other parts allowed to go to back and river. Because
so
of the local authorities.
As a trunk road, is
the
that...
The trunk roads were taken over the early
years.
Sorry?
As a trunk road, I would have thought it was a national type.
Yeah.
Not until a later period. So it wasn't until the end of the 1930s where the Trunk Road Act came in, where they became national infrastructure. For a long time, including the period here, they were all local authority, local borough councils, even the main roads, the trunk roads.
Lady at the back.
I was wondering if local authorities have shown that they have these cycleways from the past, they decide they don't want to do anything about it, what can anybody do? Is there any legal instruments? What
this
power do you have?
Sweet deal. We are working with the Willing. So we're probably going to be working with Leicester, we're going to be working with Nottingham, because these are local authorities who sussed that they've got these things. They heard the Today programme, or they've looked at the blog. They've realised they're there. They've realised it wouldn't actually take that much, because the backbone is there. The infrastructure wouldn't need that much to bring back to modern standards. But you've got to work with the Willing. So there are lots of local authorities who, I should imagine, wouldn't give us stuff. If we went to them and said, we've got the most perfect infrastructure, who cares? You go somewhere else, and I think they will. So we've got to work with them.
Anything legal that you can use to force them into it?
Maybe in 20 years' time, when other examples have been shown to work. Until then, no. It's got to be, we've got to work with their goodwill.
Oh.
And they've got to want to do this. But some of them do. So Nottingham's got an amazing network. And it's not just because Raleigh was there, even though it was connected to cycleways, Raleigh and Nottingham had an enormous amount of social housing, council housing, enormous amount. And they're all connected with trunk roads and with cycleways, and they could be quite easily brought back. And the local authority has been in touch with me directly and said, we want to do this, let's do it. So we've got to work with those people first.
Okay, one final question then. James.
In the city centre, there are two routes where cyclists used to be able to go, and which I used myself a lot in the 1950s, which are now locked to cyclists. And don't appear on our cycling map, much to my annoyance. And these are All Saints Passage, first of all, which was a cycle route, an important cycle route, and now is pedestrians only. And the second one is Christ's Lane, which is which some cyclists do use, but it is actually prohibited for cyclists to use it. And I used to use that absolutely every day in the 1950s. Mm-hmm. And it's quite wide enough to have it as a proper cycle route, properly marked as a separate cycle route on this lane. And I think we ought to be actively campaigning to get that reinstated. All Saints Passage is a bit more difficult because it is narrow, but I would have thought that that too should be claimed.
James, I don't know. It does sound as though that's like a pre-existing, nothing to do with 1930s built infrastructure, unless the road was new. It doesn't sound as though the roads are new. So. But
the roads have been there for thousands of years.
Yeah, it doesn't sound as though just the names. It doesn't sound as though it's a new road. So that's something up to you and the campaign group and the local authority to fight with. I don't think there's anything there from this particular period to suggest they'd have been used back then, apart from the fact that everybody's using everything back then, because we were the majority users on the road everywhere, not just
Okay, well.
Okay.
And do remember that books are available if you would like to purchase them.